Church. We have a few announcements we want to share with you this morning. The first one, I'm going to ask you to do something right now, okay? So everybody get with me on this. Would everybody get your cell phone out? Yeah, in church, you got permission that today to get your cell phone out. You're going to have to put it away after this is over, though, okay? But unless you use it for, this is what I usually hear, I'm using it for my Bible.
Yeah.
No, I know a lot of people do. So, here's what I'm going to ask you to do, okay? I'm going to ask you to do this. I want you to text. Open up your text. I want you to text McQueenieBCAPP. That's the message. McQueenieBCAPP. It's up there on the screen. It doesn't. I don't think it has to be all caps, but I would just go ahead and do that. And then I want you to text that to the number 77977. That's the phone number that you're going to send it to. It's not a phone number, but, okay? And then it's going to give you an opportunity to download the McQueenie app, okay? So, you know, you're going to have this right up there with, let's see, you're going to have it up there with your calendar, weather, and how many of you have a stock thing on your phone? Some of you. Okay, so you got apps for everything. Now you have one for McQueenie Baptist Church. And most of the things you find on our website, you'll find on the McQueenie app. So if you're somewhere and you want to know, hey, what time is this event happening? You can just pull out your phone, go to the McQueenie app, and it'll tell you. Okay, you can find everything you need on there. Okay, I see everybody still working on that. You got it? Didn't work? It didn't work?
Well, mine was off.
I got one over here. Got a thumbs up. Okay. I had somebody just say, I'm not too savvy. I get that. Believe me. So if you are one that says, I'm not that savvy, I want you to go and see Clifton Stapleton after the service is over. Yeah, that's you, Clifton. He's Mr. Tech guy. No, he'll help you. He'll help you get that. The reason we want to do this is just another way for us to stay in touch with our members, especially as we continue through this crazy time that we're in, all right? There's also a way on there, like if you want to give your offerings, but you don't want to have to fill out, make a check or do all that, you can do it right online. You can even set it up where it's done on a recurring basis and you don't even have to think about it anymore. So just keep all those things in your prayers. And if you need help with that, see Clifton or Connor, and they will be glad to help you. Don't see me, though, because I can't help you. Okay. All right, Operation Christmas Child. Every year we do Operation Christmas Child, where we send shoebox gifts all over the world as a part of Samaritan's Purse. And this year, because of the COVID-19, we're not going to do our usual packing party. We usually meet on a Wednesday night, and we have everything out. We pack, the kids come in, we pack the boxes. This year, we're going to do it differently. We're not able to do that. So here's what I'm asking you to do. Parents, grandparents, anybody that has a child, get your child out in both of the foyers, out here and out there. You'll find plastic shoe boxes. There's a list of the items that they recommend for boys and for girls. You can pick up a shoe box. And here's the thing. Take your child or your grandchild, go to the store, and let them pick out the things that they want to give to that child that they're sending it. You know, what we do is really good. I think the kids love it, but this is also can be a real blessing. So do that, and then have those boxes back here by November the 22nd, because we need to have them back in time to get them back to Samaritan's Purse so they can be sent out around the world, okay? And if you have a question about that, you can talk to Lauren Rodriguez. She's kind of heading this up with our Awana program. So keep that in your prayers. Pick up a box after church. Today at 5:30, I'm having my newcomer class. So if you're new to McQueenie Baptist Church, maybe you're thinking about membership, but you're not so certain about this pastor. This guy's just kind of strange. Come at 5:30 today, and you'll learn that I'm not as strange as I may seem, okay? And they give me an opportunity to get to know you, for you to get to know me a little bit better. And I'll just share some information about how our church functions, what we think is important, what is our vision, what are we trying to accomplish, those kind of things. We talk about our finances, everything that you could want to know, we'll share in that service. It's an hour and a half long, 5:30 to 7 o'clock. And then finally, kind of weird thing for me, never announced this before in church, but we're having a class sponsored by our safety team. Safety team is now responsible for the security of our church. And you know, with the things that have happened in the last few years with mass shootings and that sort of thing, especially after the situation at Sutherland Springs, we are taking very seriously to nail down some real security measures here to keep you safe at McQueenie. Part of that is getting some more people that will be licensed to carry a handgun, and that doesn't mean everybody in church is going to suddenly be arming up or anything like that. But it is an opportunity, and it's a very good deal on this. There's a sheet at the back of the church where you can sign up and let them know you're interested. We don't have a date and time yet, but if you'll put the information on the sign-up sheet, then they will contact you when they get a date and a time set up for the class, okay? So just wanted you to know about that. That is, I appreciate our security team, our safety team for heading that up for us. And I believe that's all the announcements this morning. Is everybody doing okay? Yeah, good? Okay, let's all stand together. I got a thumbs up from our cameraman back there. Thank you, Gary. Let's all stand up. Now, you know, we're not doing a greeting time, but I want you to turn around and say howdy to somebody. Okay, howdy. We're in Texas. Howdy. Now let's worship together.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. O my soul, I worship the holy name. Sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time. Here I am.
I've already heard the sermon this morning at 8:30, and he talks about, I've been changed. That's what I'm singing, but I'm singing about a different I've been changed. I've been changed in the twinkling of an eye. Mine's the new birth, so keep them separate. Been changed. I've been newborn. All my life has been rearranged. What a difference it made when the Lord came and stayed in my heart. Oh yes, I've been changed. All my sins were as scarlet, they're white as snow. But today I am free. I was lost in the darkness, but now am found. I was blind, but now I see. I've been changed. I've been newborn. All my life has been rearranged. What a difference it made when the Lord came and stayed in my heart. Oh, yes, I've been changed. Like the poor Hebrew children, I wandered long in a bare desert land to and fro. But I crossed over Jordan to Canaan's land, where the milk and honey flow. When at last in his presence I stand above, he shall wipe all the tears from my eyes. And I'll thank him for giving a wretch like me lasting hope beyond the skies. I've been changed. I've been newborn. All my life has been rearranged. What a difference it made when the Lord came and stayed in my heart. Oh, yes, I've been changed. What a difference it made when the Lord came and stayed in my heart. Oh, yes, I've been changed. I'm changed.
Thank you, Dean. Great job this morning. Beautiful, beautiful song. Yeah. Joe, great worship service too. Little girl just been to church with her mom and heard a message on the second coming of Jesus. And so she said, Mom, is Jesus really coming back? And Mom said, yes, honey, he's really coming back. Well, could it be this week? She said, yes, it could be this week. Well, could it be today? She said, well, I guess, yes, it could be today. Could it be in the next few minutes? She said, yeah, dear, I guess it could be in the next few minutes. In that case, Mom, you need to fix your hair in the back right there. Yeah, it's, you know, you need to get ready. You get ready for it, right? Going to meet Jesus after all. Well, I'm looking around and I think, I think most of you have your hair combed. I'm fixed. I'm not going to point out anybody that might not, but, you know, yeah. But the question is not, you know, is our hair ready, but are we ready? Okay, are we ready to meet the Lord? That's really the point of this message series. You know, because I believe that a lot of the things we're going to talk about over the next weeks, and, you know, as we talk about what's happening in the tribulation and all the things that happen, you know, we will not be here to experience those things. What we need to think about is, are we ready when that time comes? And so that's the point. That's really the heart of the message, not only for yourself, but maybe your children, maybe your parents, maybe your neighbor, maybe the person you work with. It's important. That's our job then during this period of time. Our job is to go, therefore, into all the world and make disciples. That's to bring people into the kingdom so they will be ready for what we are going to talk about this morning. Now, we've been talking out of the book of Matthew chapter 24. But let me just remind you, once again, really need to have this in your mind. When Jesus was talking to his disciples there on the Mount of Olives, when he was giving this instruction to his disciples and they were asking him about the temple being destroyed and his second coming, you need to remember that Jesus was not talking to his disciples as he would be speaking to the church. He was speaking to the Jewish nation. His disciples were all Jews. And everything that they understood about Christ, the Messiah's coming, they never had any inkling of Christ coming as a suffering servant that Isaiah talked about. They never had any idea of him coming to this earth for a first visitation, and then being many, many years after the death, after the burial and resurrection, after he ascended into heaven, there being a time period before he would come for a second time. They saw, and all the Jews did, this being one event happening, the Messiah coming and the end of the age happening. So they were thinking in that. Now Jesus, Paul later talks about that very thing, what happens from the time Jesus is resurrected and ascends until the second coming. He talks about that period of time as a mystery that's now being revealed. It was held back. It was kept in God's care until the church age. Okay? So think about that. Now that's the reason that when we preach out of Matthew 24 to really understand it. Remember, we said in order to unravel it and make sense of it, we need to pull a number of different threads. Last week, the thread that we pulled was out of Daniel chapter 9. Today, we're going to be talking about the rapture of the church. And last Sunday after the message, I had one of the teenagers, one of the young ones, a middle school teenager, came to me, and you know, last Sunday I preached about the Antichrist. So this teenager came to me, and he was very, very specific. He said, "Now you said that when this guy shows up, we won't be here, right?" I said, "That's absolutely right." And so it occurred to me that this is probably the right time to talk about that and talk about the answer to that question in more detail. So we're going to have two messages about the rapture of the church. The first is going to be today when we answer the question, what is the rapture? And then next week, we're going to talk about when is the rapture? When is that going to take place? So for today, the thread that we're going to pull is found in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, beginning in verses 13. And as you find that, I want you to listen while I read the passage again out of Matthew 24. That's going to be our springboard to 1 Thessalonians. This is what Jesus said to his disciples. "Therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation," that is the appearance of who? The Antichrist, that's right. "Spoken of by Daniel the prophet, standing in the holy place, and whoever reads, let him understand. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains." Down in verse 21, "For then there will be great tribulation, such as has not been since the beginning of the world until this time, no, nor ever shall be. And unless those days were shortened, no flesh would be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days will be shortened." So Jesus talks about this great tribulation that's coming. And he doesn't explain the difference between the first coming and the second coming, but he talks about the great tribulation that is coming, which, by the way, remember I said that the great tribulation period is going to be primarily focused on the redemption, on dealing with Israel over their unbelief. You know, they've never believed. All these years, they've rejected Christ as a nation. Now, there are believing Jews, we know that, but over the years, the nation itself, the people, have rejected Christ as the Messiah. And the period of tribulation is going to bring the nation of Israel to the point where they are broken and receive Jesus as their Savior. And so that's the point of the tribulation period. So this morning, as we look at 1 Thessalonians, the question is, to us is about the church, about us. Okay, what about us? What this tribulation that Jesus talks about that's going to be so horrible, what happens to us? What happens to the church? And then the second question that is being specifically asked in 1 Thessalonians, the Thessalonians are asking Paul specifically, what about those who have already died? Now, the Thessalonians already have had a teaching. They had already received some instruction about the second coming, about the rapture, about the saints being taken out. Because Paul says, you don't need me to write to you about that. They had already had some instruction. But they were asking, well, what about those that have already died and been buried, or those that have been burned up in a fire somewhere? What about them? They were worried that the believers who had died are not going to be able to be a part of this second coming and what Christ is going to do. And so this is specifically the question that Paul is answering, but then he also gives us a deeper understanding as well. So let's read 1 Thessalonians beginning in chapter 4, verse 13. It says, brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who fall or those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. This passage is probably one of the most important eschatological passages in the Bible that really brings some enlightenment about what is going to happen. I mean, it's very specific. It is very clear. And it actually builds upon and brings deeper revelation into something that Jesus himself had said to his disciples. But remember, they still didn't quite understand. They still didn't quite get. It had to be revealed during this time. Paul's teaching brings a deeper understanding that the disciples just didn't quite have when Jesus was with them. In fact, Jesus speaks about his second coming in John chapter 14. And I want to look at that passage just briefly. John chapter 14, beginning in verse 1, it says this. Jesus said to his disciples, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. Now, you know, very often, most often, in fact, when I look at that passage, it's usually, frankly, in the context of a funeral service that I'm doing, that and 1 Thessalonians. Why? Because these are passages of encouragement for those of us that are alive that have lost those ones that we love. And here Jesus is talking to his disciples, and I take John chapter 14, verses 1, begin there. I take that as the fact that we can hold that as kind of a reality for now, and we can also see it as a promise for the future. The reality for now is this, that when you die, when I die, I know the Lord is my Savior, and I believe that when I die, I think the first person I'm going to see is Jesus. I mean, I think, you know, we're going to go to be with him. The Bible tells us that to be absent from the body is to be with the Lord, and I think the first face that we are going to see, and I often tell people, listen, Jesus said, I'm going to come back and receive you to myself, and I believe that's a promise for today. But I think more specifically, it is a promise for the future. I think Jesus is giving an insight to his disciples about what is to come. And he said, I don't want you to be troubled. Yes, this is going to be a trying time, but you believe in God, believe also in me. And he says it down in verse 3, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will what? I will come back. I will come again, and I will receive you to be with me. So that's a promise of the Lord. And then Paul comes along, and he gives us more detailed. He said, this is a revelation that you need, that's going to help you, that's going to give you understanding. And so I want to take this passage that Paul gives us in 1 Thessalonians, and I'd like to break it down just a little bit and see what this rapture is. What is it that we're talking about? What's going to happen at the end of the age? Well, the first thing is this. I just want you to see that the first thing is it's the resurrection of the dead. There are just mainly two points here, okay? There's the resurrection of the dead, and there's the rapture of the living. Okay, and so I want to begin with the resurrection of the dead. And the first thing that Paul says is, I do not want you to be uninformed. Have you noticed? He says that I don't want you to be uninformed. And then over in Matthew, in the passage we were reading, he says, whoever reads, let him what? Let him understand. You remember what Daniel said over in the passage we read in Daniel? He said, this is given so that you will understand, Daniel, so that you will have understanding. You understand that God wants you to understand these truths. It's not a secret to be held. Now, there were elements of it that were a secret, that were hidden up until now, but we are living in an age where revelation has been given. God wants you to understand what's going to happen at the end of this age, and he wants you to know what the promises are for you and for your loved ones who have gone before you, who are in Christ. Don't be uninformed. The second thing he says, I don't want you to be grieved as those who have no hope. Listen, we have the hope that when we die, our spirits go to be with the Lord. I know that my mom and dad, they were great Christian people. In fact, on both of their tombstones, it says a godly man, a godly woman. They were that kind of people. And they have gone on. They've been placed in a grave, and I don't have them with me anymore. But listen, I have the hope of eternal life. I have the hope that I'm going to see my mom and dad again. And so we have that promise, that hope. We don't grieve as those who have no hope. But we also need to understand that when the end of this age comes, when God's judgment finally comes upon this world, and it is coming. But when God's judgment comes upon this world, we need to know that God has a plan for his people. God has a purpose for his people, that we will go to be with him. And we don't have to be afraid. He's going to come and take us to be with him. Then I want you to see that this passage, the whole idea of the rapture, the resurrection of the dead and the rapture of the church, this whole idea is built on the foundation of Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. See, right here in the middle of the passage, in verse 14, Paul says this, for we believe that Jesus died and rose again. Why would he put that right in the middle of this passage? Well, because he is connecting, tying our death and our resurrection with the death and the resurrection of Jesus. Because you see, there would be no resurrection for us, not to glory, if it weren't for Christ. And it says that, first of all, it says that Jesus died. You know, Jesus literally died. He didn't swoon. He didn't faint. He wasn't just resuscitated. Jesus died on the cross. He was a dead man, and he was placed in a borrowed tomb. So Paul says we need to understand that Jesus died. And those of us, you see, those of us who die, who are Christians, who are believers, we die in Christ. We are in him. We die. We are in Christ. Why is that important? That's important because the scripture says, Paul also says, but he died, but he what? He rose again. And because Jesus died and rose again, we are in Christ, so we die. What happens to us? We rise again. Hallelujah is right. We are going to rise again. Now, until that time, this old body, you know, I sometimes feel like I got one foot already over there in the grave. And I woke up, you know, a couple of days ago, oh, my back's kind of hurting. You know, why is it hurting? Well, it's because somebody would say, you're getting old. Listen, this old body is going to deteriorate and wear out, and I'm going to die. Unless Jesus comes again, unless what we're talking about today happens, I'm going to die. And you know what? I hate to break the bad news to you. So are you. But when that happens, this spirit, the Bible says to be absent from the body is to be with the Lord. When I die, this spirit is going from here. It's going to heaven. It's going to see Jesus. It's going to be with the Lord. But this old body, it's going to be put in a grave, or it's going to be incinerated. It's going to be, you know, people get kind of worked up about that. Well, you know, the body, how can God raise a body that, you know, if we get burned up, you know? And, well, I don't know. I just don't know. I just suppose that the God that said, let there be light, and there was light. The God that spoke and said, let there be darkness, and there was darkness. Let there be an earth, and there was an earth. The God that spoke and things came into existence, I suppose, can resurrect a dead body and one that's burned up and bring it back together. It is going to be a supernatural act of God, and you're going to have a new body. Yes. And how is this going to happen? According to the Lord's own word, Paul said. People sometimes, what does that mean? It could mean that Paul actually had a teaching that came from the Lord that wasn't actually printed in the Bible. You know, the scripture does say that if everything Jesus said and did was recorded, there wouldn't be enough books in the world to contain it all. So, I mean, that could be a legitimate argument, but I really don't believe that's what's happening here. Why? Because I don't believe Jesus gave teaching about this topic. Why? Because it was a hidden mystery. The church had not been born. Jesus had not died. He had not been buried. He had not been resurrected. He hadn't ascended into heaven. The Holy Spirit had not been given. The church had not been birthed. And I believe this is a teaching, a mystery held by God for the church. And so when Paul said, by the word of the Lord, I believe God revealed this to Paul, as I believe God revealed many things to the Apostle Paul. Paul gave Paul a new revelation about what was going to happen. Praise God. Don't you praise God that what he gave us is so clear and precise? He said, this is by the word of the Lord. So you can do what? That's right. You can take this to the bank. You can cash that check, friend. What God says, God will do. Not like some of these blowhard prophets I see around today that say they're speaking the word of the Lord, but it never happens. You know what they would happen to them back in the Old Testament days? They'd take them out and stone them. That's what they would happen. Because anything God says, God will do, right? And this is by the word of the Lord himself. Believers who are alive will not precede those who sleep. Man, there's so many different messages. I keep saying, I could do a message on what does it mean that now death is sleep. I'll just suffice to say that we talk about death for a believer being sleep. Because why? Because when we go to sleep, we wake up again and we rise. When in death, for us, when we go to sleep in death, we rise again. See, it's all about death, burial, but resurrection. It's all about the resurrection, and we will not precede our brothers and sisters and moms and dads and aunts and uncles and grandparents and brothers and sisters who have died, who are in Christ before us. They're put in a grave, and we will not precede them. They're going to precede us. They're going to see Jesus. Man, might not be, it'd just be a twinkling of an eye sooner, but they're going to see him first. And then at this point in the passage, I think we kind of see a transitional time in this passage, because here at this point it's been talking about the resurrection of the dead, but here's where we begin to transition into what about those who are still alive. Okay, so what he's about to say applies to the resurrection of the dead, but it also applies to those who are alive at that time. And so in verse 16 it says, isn't this where it gets good? Are you like me? This gets good, doesn't it? Listen to what he says. For the Lord himself, not a representative, not an angel, the Lord himself, Jesus Christ, bodily, the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with a voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. The Lord will come down from heaven. He's going to leave his throne, and he's going to come down to this earth. Now, don't get this confused with the bodily return of Christ to the earth. That's going to happen after the tribulation period, that very end of time. Jesus will bodily come to this earth. But at this point, we're never told in this passage that Jesus comes all the way to the earth. It says that he comes, and the dead are raised, and they meet him where? They meet him in the air. So at this point, Jesus is only returning to raise those who are in Christ who are dead, and then to change those who are alive. And it says, with a loud command. Doesn't that just make the hair stand up on the back of your neck? that Jesus himself is going to come down from heaven in the clouds and he's going to give a vocal command. And when he does, I know you've heard this before. I got to say it, though. In fact, I found a reference to what I'm fixing to say in a comment in a sermon by W.A. Criswell, 1958. That's how long ago it was. But W.A. Criswell in that comment said that when Jesus stood at the graveside of Lazarus and he commanded Lazarus, he shouted, see, Lazarus, come forth. That if he hadn't have said Lazarus by name, what would have happened? You've heard that before, right? The whole graveyard would have emptied because when Jesus commands dead to come forth, they will come forth. So he called out Lazarus. But what I want you to see is it says that he did that with a shout. And when Jesus comes again in the clouds, he's going to give a shout. And when he does, the graves are going to open up and every dead Christian is going to be raised to life and be brought up to be with him. And then what happens after that? Well, after that, it says that the voice of the archangel sounds. I'm not sure what the archangel is going to say. But man, that makes my hair stand up too. Who is the archangel? Think about it. Around for all of these millennia, the archangel who fought for God's people, Michael, the archangel is going to come down. He's going to shout. He's going to, with the voice of the archangel, they're going to call God's people from all over this earth. And they're going to sound a trumpet. Said the trumpet will sound. Trumpet call of God. Again, man, we could preach a whole message on the trumpet call. You know, what does this mean? You know, we see the trumpet used. Usually a trumpet was a call to worship. A call to worship God. This is a call for God's people to rise from the dead and for the living to be changed and to worship, go into the presence of God to worship him. It was also, the trumpet was used in the wilderness when the people were traveling in the wilderness and they had the tabernacle and they would sound a trumpet and it was time to get ready, trying to load up the tabernacle, take it down and pack up your things. And when the trumpet sounded a second time, it was almost time to go and they had to finish their preparations. And when the trumpet sounded the third time, it was what? Time to move out. We're moving through this wilderness. Same thing happened in the Roman army during these days. The Roman army would sound a trumpet, and that was a sign that the centurion or the soldiers were to gather their packs, gather their gear, get their weapons sorted and ready to go. Second trumpet would sound, and it was time to line up. If you weren't ready, you better have your stuff together. Get in line. It's time to go to war. And they would all line up, and then what would happen when they blow the third trumpet? Let's move out. It's time to march. I don't know what this means exactly, but I have a good feeling that when the trumpet call sounds, it's going to be a call for God's people. It's the last trumpet. We've heard the other trumpets up until now. It's time to get ready. It's time to prepare. Get your stuff in order. But when the last trumpet sounds, the preparation time is over, and it's time to go. The final trumpet will sound, and the dead in Christ will rise. And that moves us to the second thing, and that is the rapture of the living. Won't take quite as long. Because it happens pretty quick. That's right. He says, and after that, we who are still alive. Briefly, just Paul, when he said we, I think he's using that in a general sense, talking about believers. But I do believe, if you read Paul's writings, you couldn't help but recognize that Paul, he was like that little girl, you know, we're talking about. He expected it could be any minute now, right? We need to get ready. Paul said this. He said, after that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will be with the Lord forever. Some people get concerned about the word rapture. You know, they say, well, I don't read my Bible. I don't see rapture in the Bible. That's true. It's not. Rapture is a theological term that's used to define a doctrinal truth. You don't see the word Trinity in the Bible either, do you? But it's a theological term that is designed to give us understanding about a doctrinal truth, the Trinity of God. So the rapture is a theological term meant to give us clarity, understanding, or a definitive word for a doctrinal truth that we see in Scripture. And literally, the word in Greek that's used there is the word harpazo, and it defines the word caught up. It says, and we will be caught up together with them in the clouds. So that caught up is the word we're talking about. And when the Bible is translated from the original languages into the Latin, which is called the Vulgate translation, and it was first translated from Greek into Latin, the word that was used there is the Latin word rapire. And it again means to be caught up or snatched away. And so many of our English words, where do we find the roots of many of our English words? In Latin. So the word rapture comes from the Latin word rapire, which comes from the words caught up. Okay, so that's just a little bit about that. So don't let anybody, try to tell you this is, not in the scriptures. So for a little bit of more insight in this, let's quickly look at 1 Corinthians 15, 52. It says, listen, Paul says, I tell you a mystery. See what I'm saying? Now this, Paul is saying, this is something that has been hidden. It's not just a kind of an idea, not just a flowery word to use like, oh, this is a mystery. It's hard to understand. No, it's a mystery because it was hidden till now. That's important. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. See? Thessalonians, last trumpet. 1 Corinthians, last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. How's this going to happen? In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, the amount of time it takes for the light to glimmer off of my eye, that's how fast it's going to happen. In that moment, the dead in Christ are going to be raised. And in that moment, that twinkling of an eye, you and I, if we're alive at that time, will not have to face death. We will have instantaneous victory over death. Similar to what happened to Enoch, it says in the Old Testament, Enoch walked with God and he was no more. He was just taken on to be with God. He was so close to the Lord. I think about Elijah, one of my heroes of the Old Testament. Elijah says that he went across that river and the chariot of God, chariot of fire, came down from heaven and swept him away. Elijah never experienced physical death, but was changed in a moment, translated and taken to be with God in heaven. Folks, that's what's going to happen to the believers who are alive at this time. And it's going to happen, listen, it's going to happen just as surely as we are sitting here and I'm standing here this morning. It will happen. For the perishable must clothe itself. This is verse 53 in 1 Corinthians 15. For the perishable must clothe itself with imperishable, the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with imperishable and the mortal with immortality, then the saying is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. There it is. Oh, where, death, is your victory? Where, oh, death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Will be changed in a moment in the twinkling of an eye, and this old perishable body that's dying and decaying, even as I stand here, will be changed into an immortal body. This old perishable body can't inherit heaven, can't be in God's presence, but the one he gives me then will be. It'll be perfectly immortal, imperishable. Final thing I just want to mention is verse 17. It says, when this happens, after this happens, we will be with him for how long? Forever. And then the last thing I'm asking is this. Who is it that's going to hear the voice of Jesus when he commands? There's going to be a lot of people that won't. There's going to be a lot of people that won't. The ones, listen to me, I want you to listen very carefully to what I'm going to say in closing. The ones that will hear the voice of Jesus when he comes in the clouds and gives a shout are the very same ones this morning that are hearing his voice right now. And if you don't hear his voice right now, you see, the Spirit of God is in this place. You know, before every service this morning, I spend more time, I pray. I really do. I pray, God, give me a word, Lord. Speak through me. Make what I'm saying true and bring it to the hearts of your people. Only the Spirit of God can do that. And so I believe by faith that when I preach the word, God's Spirit is speaking. And if you don't hear his voice this morning, if you don't hear the voice of God, it's a good chance you won't hear it then. Because only he can give you ears to hear. And if you don't hear the Lord this morning, if you've never trusted him as your Savior, then let me tell you something. I wouldn't walk out of this place. I wouldn't take one step out of that back door if I didn't know Jesus as my Savior, if I wasn't hearing the voice of God in my life. Heavenly Father, I thank you this morning that you're here, that you're speaking, that this is your time, these are your people. God, for those that don't know you this morning, we pray for them that you might speak into their lives. God, I pray that you would open hearts today and speak truth. Lord, I guess my saddest thought is that we would have a soul sitting right here in this church this morning under the preaching and the teaching of your word. And they would say no to you, turn around, walk out to everlasting death. So God, I pray if there's anyone here that's never made that commitment of their life, that they would do so today. Lord, for the rest of us, Lord, that maybe we've gotten slack. Maybe we've just gotten lazy. Maybe we've just gotten selfish. Maybe we just become overwhelmed by things of the world. But Lord, that you would bring us back to that deep commitment, that walk with you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand with me? So we go into this time of invitation today. If you've never trusted Jesus, I'll be here to meet you at the front and pray with you. Maybe you just need a prayer of commitment or whatever it is. If you have a need this morning, know that I would be glad to pray with you. The altar is also open if you just want to come and kneel and pray. So as we worship during this time, this is your time to respond to what you hear this morning.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. And mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes, a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. Open wide, forgiveness was born.
thank you so much for being here today. And be sure that you invite somebody to church next week, okay? Let them know that God is working in this place and invite them to come. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. By the way, don't forget the newcomer class tonight. And if you're going to make it to that class, I don't have a sign-up sheet out. Just come see me after the service. Say, I'll be there, okay? I'd love to have you to be a part. So let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this time. Go with us now as we leave here our separate ways. Lord, that your Spirit would be upon us and guide us every step, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.